It's a calling. That's why you keep coming back.
It's an immediate hit on that crack pipe of approval.
And in a room of, say, 200 or 300 people, or sometimes 2,000 or 3,000 people, you're the only one facing the runway.
When they're on the stage, they want to kill.
For thousands of generations, human beings have been defined by the tribes they were born into. Today, we're still totally tribal. But in the 21st century, we decide which nation to belong to. And today's tribes are a whole new species.
I knew that I wanted to step beyond the conventions of the fourth wall. You know, I wanted to have that relationship with an audience. You wanted to, and that was hard, you know. That's also the thing that separates the comedian from the actor. You know, the actor always maintains that fourth wall, where the comedian's job is to break it. The comedian's job is to bring everybody in.
One of the easiest tribes to find, on stage and on television, is one of the most difficult to survive in. It's the tribe of stand-up comics, a band of men and women who make a living from laughter, by laughing at the way we live.
Climate change, that's got everybody going, doesn't it? Eh? There's animals showing up in the Arctic like Noah's Ark, dropping them off at the wrong beach. And that's ticking the Inuit people off, because it takes those folks a week to name something they know. Rabbit.
I mean, we make our living standing in front of a microphone with a stool and a glass of water, making strangers laugh for money.
There's nothing funny about a Canadian winter, but inside Spirits Bar in Toronto, 13 men and women of varying ages, ethnicities, and talent are telling their best jokes and not getting paid for it. It's open mic night. A chance for members of the tribe to try out a few minutes of new material. Few outsiders understand that giving jokes away for free is a big part of being a professional.
Now, I lived in Los Angeles for a while with two big black roommates, and I wanted to talk about racism. They both did comedy too, and they're like, Rob, do not talk about racism. I was like, why the f*** not? He's like, Rob, because you're white, motherfucker. That's why, you're white. Can't talk about racism. I was like, but we invented it.
Comedy is the most difficult art form that we have. You either laugh or you don't. There's no ambiguity.
It's great to be heckled in for 30 seconds.
So for someone to pursue a form of art where you bare your soul in front of people and they can reject you in front of your face, you gotta really want that big laugh that you get.
Big controversy about the testing on animals. Testing makeup on animals, that's what everybody's about. I always wonder what results they're looking for. Pictured in the lab with the clipboard, you know, I've never seen that chipmunk with such confidence.
Not many comics make a living from their rants and ravings. Those who fill the big theaters become the tribe's most honored chieftains, with hundreds of would-be warriors below them in the hierarchy. To move up, to make stand-up a full-time career, requires a melding of clever writing, stage presence, and the ability to hit the heart of the human condition.
I thought that it would have happened faster. I thought you just go up on stage, you get seen, and then you'll get your Letterman show, and then you get this show, you get your sitcom, an HBO special.
Because I'm a lazy guy, I can't wake up to alarm clocks, man. Just push that snooze button, it's like, burnt. I can do that for 5 hours. What you need to do is get the alarm clock, put it across the room, and put broken glass on the floor. I can sleep through music, and you sleep through music? That just becomes a soundtrack to my dreams. Just me and Gwen Stefani running in a forest. Can't believe you married me. Why do you keep talking about the traffic, Gwen?
You come full circle after 10 years, and your real self comes out. And you're like, my God, this is what I was trying to do 10 years ago, But how come it only comes out now is because it takes you 10 years to be that comfortable for your real voice to come out.
I started to do stand-up because I have to do it. It's just in me to do it.
But like I was saying this at a show, and this girl's like, hey man, you know, these two drunk girls were in fashion school, and I'm like, you can't talk about fashion like that because it's an important part of this planet. I'm like, okay, whatever. They kept yelling at me, and she's like, are you wearing underwear right now? And I was like, yeah. And she's like, well, a fashion designer designed those. It's like, really? That's your, like, how hard is it to cover balls? You know what I mean? Like you had to go to school and write an exam to do that shit. Like a well-placed teacup. They're out of the way.
I found what was alluring about it is that you can say whatever you want to say, and people have to listen to it.
I'll tell you what's funny about these. Obviously nothing. Obviously not one thing. No, off. This isn't, I don't care. I'm not crying, I'm just talking. It's just like, obviously the punchlines are not where they should be. And you know what's funny? This is the...
There's a reason I do this, and whether it's a calling or what I was born to be done, whatever the cliche is, that's what it is.
Because I think the magic box of television is ramming shit down our throats nobody cares about. For example, does anyone really care about Britney Spears' complete mental breakdown? No. Angelina Jolie and her babies? Like, I give a can't wait till next week, huh? War in Iraq, bad. Global warming, worse than we thought. Shiloh made us stinky. Poopy, bad.
I have the kind of nicer act, and I have the X-rated act. If it's billed as X-rated, anything goes.
About you guys, like when I go on the road?
Or I run a bunch of rooms, two rooms in the city, and since I've started, I've always created rooms because I needed a place to perform. So I think that, yeah, my nickname's Mama, so I think that they see me as the Mama of the Toronto alternative scene.
Okay, also, I need to know, can you do the Eaton House on Tuesday?
Joanna is a fixture of the Toronto scene, a matriarch of the tribe. She MCs the open mic nights at Spirits, watching the novices open their careers and their souls.
She runs two of the best rooms in town for young comics, and a lot of people forget that. Without Joanna and doing these rooms, a lot of comics wouldn't get better.
She performs regularly at other clubs, too experienced to open the show, not quite big enough to close it.
I realized this about 2 years ago, that I was a cougar. I was doing a show, and I got off stage, and one of the waitresses working at the club brought me this note, and on the note it said, I think you're really hot. I want to meet you after the show, Scott. I said, Scott, how old are you? He says, 17. My ovaries froze. That's not normal. I'm like, 17. I'm like, dude, because I know how to talk to the babies. I'm like, dude, I said my age on stage. You know how old I am. He goes, I know. I bet you could teach me stuff. Like, what do you need, long division? What the hell am I going to help you with? I know. So we dated for 2 months, right? And then what happened? I know, not long.
I was really good at making people laugh around the water cooler, but then when I had to translate it to stage, it was a whole different ballgame.
Yeah.
Because there's a difference between sitting in a kitchen and telling a story and then learning how to tell it on stage, which was a skill I had to learn. And that took me probably 5 years to get consistent at.
Well, the rite of passage now is just time. You're on stage, and you're on stage some more, and then more and more. It takes a long time to go from amateur night to being a regularly paid performer.
You have to fight and fight and fight. Because it takes a minimum of 7 to 8 years to just get 7 or 8 or 9 minutes down that are fantastic.
The sub-tribe of female comics comes with its own rituals and rules.
2 years ago in downtown Toronto, I entered a wet t-shirt contest and won. I know. All the other girls wore the t-shirts, idiots. I was the winner.
I think it is a boys' club, and I think that it's very hard for female comics to shake that boys' club image.
In fact, my first roommate in Toronto was a gay man. Oh my God, ladies. He cooked, he cleaned.
Some people will say they expect me to talk about my period and shit on men. And I think that's pretty antiquated.
5 years, I never had to suck his once. It was the best relationship of my life. I miss him every day. Miss him.
They have to be a little funnier off the top to slam home their point, I deserve to be here. And it's not easy. And then you got all the man whores trying to sleep with them. All the man comics or male comics telling them they're funny because they want to sleep with them. Many female comics I saw that really hurt their career.
I don't think it's a great idea for comics to date. I don't. And I'm in a relationship with a comic, so I'm going to sound like a hypocrite. But it's not the best case scenario, okay, so because it is very competitive.
As the backdrop, right?
But the tribe of comedy is built on solidarity to the point where you're really good and you're really successful, and then it's competition.
You should know that. You should have known that years ago.
Like all tribes, modern or primitive, comics may be fractious among themselves, but they are defiantly united against the outside world.
All right, I'm going to put it in the
I think there's a real sense of community. I don't think they want to see their friends fail. I really don't. I don't see any evidence of it. What they want to see fail are people who they think aren't funny and don't belong in the tribe.
It is a society of loners and outsiders, obsessed with breaking the silence and breaking the rules. In the tribe of stand-up comics, travel is the neophyte's testing ground, and often his trauma.
You're driving back and forth across the country. Very few people can make a living just by living in a big city like Toronto. No, the reality is, it's Tuesday night and you're in Belleville.
Ron's agent has booked him for a midday show at Fanshawe College in London, Ontario. He's asked Nathan McIntosh to open a gig that's very unlikely to succeed. But it will give Nathan more of the road test toughening that every comic needs to move up in the tribe.
College and university shows generally are all out. They can go all out.
At high noon, school, though?
Yeah, because it's hard to make people laugh that early in the morning or that early in the day. They're studying, they're eating lunch. Okay. So it's not like the greatest gig, but it can be fun.
I have never done a show at noon before. The ones that I've seen, they didn't tell anybody that there was going to be a show, so people are just sort of eating lunch and then they get bombarded with jokes. Hopefully this one is not like that, but I think there'll be some challenges, yeah?
Yeah, you gotta pay your dues, though. You gotta do the whole road, traveling.
I sacrifice a lot to be a professional comedian. A stable relationship, stable job, you know, a stable family.
For Ron Josol and other stand-ups, the sacrifices are stoked by an inborn compulsion to make a world of strangers laugh.
Comedy started for me when I was 8 years old. I watched Eddie Murphy Delirious, and on that day in 1983, June, I wanted to be a comedian.
My first time, I videotaped myself, and I didn't know you had to write jokes.
Yeah.
So I just tried to improv the whole thing, and I got booed off the stage.
Karaoke, you could talk about Filipinos, screw that.
I had the tape and I hid it under my bed. And we had a family party a couple weeks after. Mm-hmm. And my brother put it in the VCR in front of the family. Only thing I saw in the tape was me. It was me in the audience going, it's not that easy, okay?
First time on stage, guys. First time on stage. Give me a break.
Everybody bums. You have to bum to get better. You can't do new material and have it not bomb. And it physically, it makes you feel sick. Like, I think I cried one time. I punched the wall. I got heckled in the wine. He sat there stares and he points and goes, this is how The Rock would look like off season. What a jerk, it took his joke pill. The idea comes to me sometimes right before I go up on stage. So I'll text the joke to myself, or actually, audio recorded on my cell phone. And then during the week, I'll put it down on a piece of paper, on a computer. In 1 week, I'll have like 15 jokes that I get to practice. I'll go down to the open mic comedy, the club, and I'll take out the piece of paper and try 15 jokes one after another. The ones that get the best laughs, I'll keep. The ones that don't, I'll stay in the computer until I can fine tune it somehow.
Can I play you one?
When I first started, I didn't want myself to be using the ethnic angle. I wanted just to be, you know, let me just do comedy. And then eventually, people would say in the crowd, hey, why don't you talk about your background? Why? Because you're different from a lot of comics we see. If you don't talk about it, then it's like the elephant in the living room.
Went to Hawaii. It's weird when you're Filipino. Go to Hawaii because everybody looks like you. You don't feel special. Come off the plane, people get lays. Where's my lay? New York with the luggage.
The fact that he's Filipino has this extra dimension and value for people who might live in a big city. But even if you didn't, it wouldn't matter because you would still get the jokes based on the fact that he's an outsider.
I had an accent up till I was 6 years old. And the report card said, Ron has a problem pronouncing his F and P's and V's and B's. He pronounces friends as prens. My dad's like, why do you pronounce prens as prens?
Ron's role model is Russell Peters, another Asian Canadian who has broken worldwide and broken the ethnic stereotype.
Here's the messed up part. Indian people were taken to South Africa as slaves. Who the hell uses an Indian slave? Do I look physically ready to do hard labor? My people don't work that hard. Give us a calculator. We'll do your taxes, man.
I took Ron on the road with me many times. So I've taken Ron to Vancouver. I've taken him on a bunch of other gigs. I had him open for me in LA a few years ago.
East Indian food's even hotter. Sometimes I shit before the menu gets there.
Now Ron is passing Russell's guidance on to Nathan, graciously giving him the chance to kill or be killed in the Nooner at the College Student Center.
Hey, Nathan, what material are you going to do today?
I don't really know. I've never done a show at noon before.
Right.
Figure it out. What do you got?
I'm going to get more dirty.
At noon? That's just what happens?
Yeah. I mean, they like it a little bit more dirty because they think you're cooler.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. He said, snap, guy. I think Nathan is nervous, but he's hiding it. One of the tricks of comedy is to hide your emotions on stage and off stage.
I always wanted to do stand-up. It scared me. It was really scary, but it was always in me to do. I always knew that one day I would try to do it.
I think it's kind of funny when high school or college ends, there's always like privileged kids that have to go find themselves. Finding yourself means f***ing strangers in random countries. Yeah, can we not agree on that shit? Oh, I have to go find myself. I have to go find some dick. That is what that f***ing means, you know? And after that guy f***s me 7 or 8 times, I'll know who I am. Yeah, I'm a guy that doesn't like to get f***ed by men.
Those of us who have embraced the discipline and answered the call know how hard it is to go from those first 5 minutes when, you know, your tongue feels like it's the size of a 13 Wellington boot and there's no spit in your mouth and you're sweating buckets and every word that comes out of your mouth seems like it's pissing the audience off.
The tribal graveyard is full of rookies who died on stage. Nathan refused to let himself fail so easily. He left his home in Nova Scotia and headed west.
If you're trying to get me to quit, sir, it's not gonna f***ing work, okay? You think I moved all the way from Halifax to quit when some f***ing decides to call me not the Joker?
The first show I ever did in Toronto was at a bar. People were yelling and stuff. Nobody was really paying attention off the top. And it actually ended up being okay. And people came up to me afterwards and said I was really funny, and it was a fun time.
It's alchemy, man. You know, it's pulling gold from straw, and I mean that with the utmost respect from the amateur who gets up and, you know, finally gets the cojones to step outside the frat house or step outside the comfort of the workplace or wherever he's living his real life and try to put those 5 minutes together on stage. It's a huge leap.
I've only been doing it about 2 years, a little over 2 years. There's a lot of people that I've met that have started and stopped. So I think in Toronto, it's basically people just wait to see if you take it seriously, if you're gonna keep coming around. And when you do, then they're like, okay, cool, he's one of us, and that's what it is.
I judged a competition at the Laugh Resort last year, and some of these young comedians on stage were just rocking, man.
And she said, Nathan, just so you know, pickup lines never work, okay? They're dumb, they're stupid. And she said, the only way they're gonna work is if you run into some slutty girl who is probably gonna sleep with you anyway. you know? And I was like, well, just to let you know, at bars, that's the girl guys are looking for.
Nathan entered the competition and was crowned best comic with a day job. A dubious honor, but a wedge into the tribe.
Got a little bit of money, got to do a set at Just for Laughs in the summer, which was really cool.
In Toronto, the coffee bars are filled with would-be stars from 1,000 Smallvilles. Starbucks pays Nathan's rent and fills his notebook with material for testing on the road.
Remember that show we did? That was a shitty road gig.
I've only been on like 10, probably 10 or 11 road shows, and that was the worst one. And I'm glad you brought that to me, Ron.
Yes.
Good time.
You know, it was weird because I would have never taken that gig at all if I knew what it was.
Yeah. We had a 12-year-old girl's karaoke machine with a microphone attached to it, and they weren't even going to give us that. We had to demand that.
Those are the kind of road shows you need a friend because you will cry.
Like warriors, the men of the tribe of stand-up comics proudly wear the scars of distant battles with the enemy. Soon, Nathan will know whether the trip to London is a breakthrough or a bomb. Some of today's stand-up comedy acts are nice enough for families. Darren Frost is triumphantly offensive.
A three-armed baby was born in China last year. The difference was it wasn't just a little nub, but a whole working third arm. And they wanted to cut it off. And I say no, because this kid could make millions in porn. Think about it.
Darren is a fascinating character because Darren sets up a guy who you love to hate, which is a complex comedy character. Yeah, he does what used to be called sick material, but the stuff is smart and pointed.
Darren, don't make fun of the three-armed baby. He's not here to defend himself. Of course he's not here to defend himself. He's too busy winning paper, rock, scissors competitions. Oh, that one's funny. Okay, I see. F*** me, I made the disability a positive ha-ha in that one. All right, I just want to know where the line of bullshit is. Okay.
Darren Frost is one of the ballsiest comics in Canada. I don't like when he calls himself the edgy guy, because he just is.
In Edmonton, a woman stood up on an X-rated show, yelled at me like this. She goes, "That's it! I've had it! I work with children with special needs!" F*** off. I don't even know what the f*** that means. Really, at a very early age, I thought, this is what I want to do. From my childhood, I was bullied a lot, so my mouth was the only way for me to get away from that. And the best way to do that, of course, it's the cliche, is to make fun of someone.
I think all of them are in it for revenge of some sort. They didn't get enough attention as a child. They got too much attention as a child. They were fat, they were thin, too skinny, too tall, too short, too Jewish, too black. And sometimes you've got combinations of all those things.
I'll never forget the first time I went on stage. I delivered the material, and unlike a lot of comics, I killed. I bought peanut butter. You notice it on the packaging? May contain nuts. It's in the f***ing product name. I got off stage and still high for 5 hours afterwards. It's a very hard thing to describe.
When they're on the stage, they want to kill. They want to have that entire audience in the palm of their hands, on their side, understanding every nuance and subtlety and, perception of what they think to be funny.
The laughter feels like an incredible rush of approval. It's an immediate hit on that crack pipe of approval. And you need it again and again and again and again. And if you don't get it, you think something's wrong.
You know, that was the same noise my mother made at me when I told her I wanted to be a stand-up comedian. They were fine with it, but they just made me make one agreement with them.
and that was to have something to fall back on. So I actually do have a degree in business administration and honors in marketing.
Darren is a one-man sales force with only one product to peddle, his own X-rated view on the weirdness of the world.
So when I'm on the road, I would take my camera, I would upload the footage, upload it to YouTube, and away we go.
The dream is that a joke will go viral, turning a million YouTube hits into $1 million.
If I just relied on traditional media, radio, newsprint, I wouldn't even be a headliner in Canada.
A lone wolf in the tribe of travelers, Darren sells his own DVDs after each show to the audience he's just finished insulting. He's almost ready to record disc number two.
Recently, I was dealing with a heckler, and they whipped a glass at my chest from 20 feet away on a balcony. Got back up and gained my composure and continued the show. It's a dirty little thing in stand-up comedy how crowds are being less and less respectful of the art form.
Okay. That guy better get the f*** out of here right now or I will call the police because that's assault.
I'm the kind of person that there's always something. It's some kind of problem or drama. So when this happened, I don't know. I just kind of went, hey, that's me. You know, it's just another thing to deal with.
Darren and his wife have had to deal with a parent's greatest fear, the loss of their children.
They're a lot of work, as two young boys are, and they both have the same congenital heart defect. So it hasn't been an easy run.
The boys' ordeal has become their father's public catharsis, humor with a painfully personal edge.
Be glad for me that I have the outlet to get rid of that anger. So when I go home, you know, like, I'll come in, my wife will be like, how was the show? Oh, they hated me. Oh yeah, just scream a lot, yeah. Okay, let's go to bed and watch TLC, you know? And literally, that is my life. Naked, I say this to my wife, I'm like, hey honey, this is all yours. Please don't picture me naked, that's not the joke. Then she said this. She goes, I can't see it. I don't have my glasses on. Oh. Oh, okay, let Mancho go.
Go get him.
You know, I think my wife likes what I do and is proud of me, but I don't think she knew what she was getting into when she signed up.
Good job.
We're just in the process of now and of like unlisting my number and a bunch of other things because it's just happening too much.
Recording the DVD has become Darren's distraction and his obsession. To kill tonight, he needs an audience that can handle his rage with respect for the irony of anger. In London, Ontario, a noontime gig for a small crowd of sober collegians is a true test of a comic's material and his mettle.
Like, I don't think there's probably one person in this room that can name six places in Manitoba. Am I right on that? Yeah, so what the f*** are we doing with Manitoba? Isn't this country in debt? Like, let's put a Walmart there or something.
I thought Nathan was just sort of warming the crowd up. It didn't seem like any huge response from them, but he had consistent laughs, which is really good.
But Toronto is pretty expensive, so I don't have cable, can't afford it. I only get two shows. I get Everyone Loves Raymond, which I'm pretty sure you get even if you don't own a TV. That show is everywhere. I think you're just putting bread in the toaster and Barone is yelling at you.
He kept to his act. He didn't try to stray off from it, and that's all he had to do. He had to stick to his act and make sure that he wasn't razzled by the crowd, that it didn't respond to certain parts that were supposed to be laughs.
So that Starbucks, as a company, can grow.
I learned that shows at noon can be kind of awkward. It's a different type of audience. Watching Ron, I saw you just have to keep going, like regardless of if there's dips in your set or whatever, just keep going through it.
And I caught this guy making fun of Asian stereotypes, so I beat him with my Hello Kitty baseball bat. But since I'm Filipino, I nursed him back to a full recovery.
I had to stay tight, in the beginning for like three quarters on the way through. I was building momentum through the whole thing, you know?
I respect any woman that gets a breast reduction, because there's no guy in this room that would shorten their dicks no matter how bad their back feels. Mr. Johnson, the size of your penis is causing back problems. We're gonna have to cut a couple. Oh, f*** you.
To me, it wasn't a kill in the standards I keep for myself, but in that situation, it was a really good show.
If it's all about balance, cut off my arms. I don't even need them.
The verdict is, it could have been worse. They're heading back to Toronto to tell their fellow tribesmen about surviving another day on the road.
Ron, I think Millen's gonna come check out one of my sets.
For Comedy Now?
Yeah, for consideration of Comedy Now anyway, which is pretty cool.
Comedy Now is a stand-up series on CTV and the Comedy Network that features one performer for each show, and it's been on air for 11 seasons now.
That is our accent, the Filipino accent. We pronounce our F and P. And V and B, vice versa.
That was my first time on TV, and it was just too overwhelming for me to do 45 minutes. Deep inside, I was falling down a cliff. I was just like, oh my God.
At a tribal powwow like this one, headliners and part-timers sit as equals. It is a time for honesty, reinforcing the solidarity of their separate, solitary lives.
It's kind of an irony that it's a tribe, yet by nature, we're loners, you know? You're alone there on stage, you're alone in front of the microphone, you're alone for the most part when you're writing your material, you're alone when you're on the road.
All my friends now are stand-up comics. Like, most of the people I live with or hung out with or whatever, I don't keep in contact with. It's not because I'm stopping, they're not returning my calls or whatever. Man, it's about me.
Yeah, I think it's us.
But I think as a group of people, we always become this kind of very centered and focused group.
A tribe, by its nature, certainly has a deference for the status quo. And it's exactly the status quo that we've stepped away from in order to answer the calling of comedy.
But I'm not at all like I was. None of us are, I think, in life. But stand-up really personifies that. You really have no self-edit. And so you end up living amongst other comedians as much as you can, because we're all alike. But when we're in the regular world, we'll slip up and say, I will.
Oh, yeah. I do.
I will. Sure. We will all shock the f*** out of a whole bunch of people.
Especially the service industry.
Oh,
if I get licked, you know, they have no idea what we do for a living. You know, I eat people like you for a living. That's my profession. Yeah,
yeah. In the tribe of stand-up comics, killing is the only goal. And originality is the only legal weapon. Because now it's not stealing a joke is a capital offense.
People don't care what's stolen, like you just said. They just want the end product.
Yeah.
And why we're noble is because we see what it takes to get that joke. And when someone steals it, that's taking your money.
Yeah.
I find it more personal than that.
I do find it.
Because most of my jokes are about my life and my old lady and everything. And when they've stolen a memory.
People do it. It's not a good thing. It is certainly a fatal thing, because another comic will kill you.
I stole one line. It wasn't like a material. And it's funny, because the dude whose joke I stole, I don't want to name names, but the guy whose joke I stole, nobody liked him. So even though I stole his material, everybody was still on my side. They were like, that guy's a dick. Good. Take it. And I was like, really? All right.
I said, hard for about a month.
I
could not stop saying, I credited you on stage.
I've done that. I've used comics lines on stage, but called them and said, by the way, on stage tonight. Yeah.
But I did it so early in my career, and I admitted to it. And I stopped right away. I mean, like, you know, if you do something wrong, you really have to take ownership of it. All right, I messed up. Don't do it again.
Stale material is almost as toxic as stolen, even for the tribal elders. The cycle of writing, refining, and rendering at open mic nights never ends.
So she starts screaming at Ricky, Ricky, the monkey's pulling my buttons! Why does it keep pulling my buttons, Ricky? I'm like, 'cause it's a f***ing monkey, okay? That's what monkeys do!
When I get really angry about something, then I'll go off and force myself to write a bunch of stuff. It's the best way of getting that feeling out of you anyway.
Yes.
There's still nothing better than looking at a piece of paper going, oh,
yeah.
Oh, I think I got something
and
here.
And finding 8 new minutes. Yeah, I go to Eat Notes the first time, the new 8 minutes.
Yeah.
Then I do it at Spirits. Yeah. Then I do it at a comic
club. That's what I do. Yeah.
The gatherings don't last long. There's always another gig to do, another gag to write. another night to stand naked in the spotlight and dare a few dozen strangers to laugh. Darren has spent months sharpening his act for tonight's DVD taping. He is looking for an enthusiastic, non-violent response from his audience.
So this is for the microphone for the audience to pick up,
yep.
That one I told you about for
great.
The feed, so.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Please welcome the one and only, when I say that, I mean it, Mr. Darren Frost.
Woo! Woo! I did something different this year, folks. I shaved my head right down to the wood. Because a friend of mine said, you gotta do that, man. It'll make you look tougher. That's what you gotta do. You gotta look tougher. So I shaved my head, and I found out very quickly, I don't look tougher. I just look like a fat Phil Collins now. A mentally unstable Phil Collins. Susu Studio, you f***ing figure it out. Okay, four people from the 80s. This is gonna go well. I had a little bit longer, wispier hair, trying to kid myself with a full head of hair. Then I sat down on a plane. The guy sat down beside me. He did this. Whenever you do this, you try to break the ice when you're on a long journey. He says something that you're both gonna find f***ing hilarious. Right? So he sits down. He turns to me, he says this, he goes, has anyone ever told you you look just like that porn star named Ron Jeremy? No. Nobody ever has. But wow, is this gonna be awkward? As I beat you with my 11-inch Hey, don't laugh all at once, it throws me off. That You don't wanna up my DVD taping, every other table, then you laugh. You know, it was an X-rated show filled with people that didn't want X-rated comedy. Sometimes it can turn around at the 3-minute mark, but it just didn't turn around. And there were moments that were funny, and there was moments of honesty in there, and that's great if it was a normal show, but it's not great for a full-length DVD.
Firstly, I never found him offensive. No, I didn't. Maybe some other people did as well. I don't know.
I was like, that's the way to go. Be, you know, try push people above that edge. So I really admire him for that.
See, other comics, they like to end big. That way they can feel good about themselves and go back to their rooms and f*** off onto themselves. I don't have to. I've tasted my own f***ing. Tonight it's gonna taste like tears. You know, so I'm out $3,000, I'm off to tape another weekend, if I have to. That's the way it is.
I warned ya!
I thought Darren's show was amazing. It was hilarious. I was just falling off my seat, and he was just cracking me up and really cracked the whole audience. It was amazing.
Across town, it's Nathan McIntosh's turn.
This guy's the fast rising star, Nathan McIntosh. Here he is now.
Nathan is preparing for the performance that could finally free him from Starbucks, because a powerful television producer will be in the house.
Getting a Comedy Now is a big accomplishment for any Canadian comic. It's often their first bit of great television tape, and it almost always leads to more things for them.
I think he has a really keen eye for comedy because he's been doing it forever. He's a very scary person to a lot of these young comics.
So worst case scenario is that he tells me never to touch a microphone again.
I've been doing this a long time, and it's pretty hard to make me laugh now. It's not that I don't appreciate what's funny, but I've seen a lot of stand-up. So anytime that something strikes me as fresh and original, I get excited about that.
I work during the day. I work at Starbucks. Check that action out.
Nathan will have to really be relaxed and just get his A material out the way he normally can.
2 weeks ago, but I got this new manager who just takes this job way too seriously, okay? It's like presidential to this guy. Like, I'm pretty sure he would jump in front of a bullet to save a caramel macchiato. I was like, man, why do you care so much about the rules and the standards of Starbucks? And he's like, well, Nathan, I want to adhere by the standards so that Starbucks as a company can grow. Yeah, I don't know if you've looked around, man. There's a Starbucks everywhere, okay? I think they've won. Like, what do you want to do? Like, there's no more room. What do you want to do? Start putting Starbucks in Starbucks?
Like, the one thing about comedy is comedy almost comes from surprise. So how people deliver their material and how they tag it, you know, varies from performer to performer, and that's what makes people stand out. Delivery is really, really important.
Well, if you can name 5 or 6 places in Manitoba, you now own f***ing Manitoba. It's yours. We weren't using it.
I think he nailed it right when the laughter from one joke is dying off. He's already hitting you with the next punchline. He brings him quick. I like him.
You know, I'm not sure if Millen really liked it or not, from a standpoint of somebody that can produce a TV show or manage a club.
I think I did good. I think it was, yeah, I think it went well. I think it went really well.
For Nathan, the question is not whether he killed, but whether or not his jokes impressed an omnipotent audience of one. It's after midnight at the Laugh Resort as Nathan McIntosh faces his moment of truth.
I kind of was waiting for you to come in with like something that really defined you right off the top, and you kind of muddled around a little bit, like right off the top, and
cool.
So you can see how they built, and you know the audience built with their laughs all the way through, and they totally bought into everything you were talking about, and you were very smart with the way that you picked on Manitoba.
Yeah, because there's not really any reason to pick on Manitoba. I just think it's hilarious.
Yeah. But it totally worked. You're getting close. I don't think it'll be this year for you, but I think we'll be talking more seriously next year.
Cool, very cool.
Yeah, I'm proud of myself, but I think tonight will not affect how my day job... Yeah, my day job will be there come Saturday, yeah.
While Nathan returns to Latte Limbo, at the Toronto nightclub called Spirits, Ron Josol is taking a leap of faith into deeply personal and painful comedy.
This weather reminds me, 4 years ago, I hit an old lady crossing a street in a crosswalk. That wasn't a joke. If you're laughing, you're sadistic, really.
I hit somebody when I was driving in Christmas or December. And how do you make that funny? Let's try to make it funny. Because I'm not doing it out of being malicious. I didn't hurt her, do it on purpose.
And her head actually dented the front of my hood. So every time it snows, I see an imprint of her face, like, ah.
I just want them to see I was scared. So there's a vulnerability on there.
I think in the past he's done a lot of, you know, playing to the audience where they've already been. And I think he's trying to move over. I've talked to him about that. I said it's a hard road, it's a long road, but it's a very rewarding one.
So now I'm in the crossroads of getting more vulnerable, talking about stories that I probably wouldn't want anybody to know.
Ron is now starting to hit his stride. And this is something I said about Ron to all our friends about 8, 9 years ago. I said, when Ron becomes Ron Josol on stage, it's over. He's going to annihilate everybody.
And some guy passed by and he goes, oh my God, that guy killed that girl. And I'm like, no, she's not dead. She's still twitching.
Sure, someone physically got hurt, but you know, in my position, I was like, oh my God, I've never killed somebody before. That was the first thing that ran into my head, that I am now a murderer. I'll probably be in jail.
The cop comes in, I go, do I go to jail? No, she's not dead, you're not drunk, you didn't flee the scene. Plus, Honda Civics were made to sweep pedestrians off their feet. I think I saw that in the brochure.
You know, it's kind of like when you listen to an artist, like a musician, and they do a bunch of fluffy albums, and then they write that one album where they really dig deep in themselves, and all the truth comes out of them. And that's the album that you go, wow.
Plus, it gave me a $40 ticket for an unsafe left. $40. I should have hit people I hated.
I'd have to keep performing it and be comfortable with the wording and the idea and the picture in my head, and everything will start to drop into place.
And that's where the talent comes in.
And, you know, it'll grow. And maybe now he's not comfortable with the joke, but in, like, 3 months, he'll be okay with it.
Pain plus time equals comedy. You have pain. After a couple months, it's no longer pain, but it's laughable.
Unified by a longing for laughter, yet as singular as snipers, the tribe of stand-up comics stalks the night, committed to a life on the stage, on the screen, and on the edge.